Today our topic is food waste and what to do about it. So we have three guests today to have a conversation about the food waste situation. The first guest to my left is Jessica Didow, who is the program project administrator for public works for the city of Reading. That's a pretty big title. Our second guest is Lucine Sihelnik. Did I say your name right?
You did.
Oh, good.
Yep.
Food System Director for Redesign Reading CDC. And our third guest is Brian Twyman, who is the Outreach Director for Permacultivate. Thank you very much for joining us for the show today. In the last couple months, food waste has been a pretty much a national topic. If you look at our local media, our regional media, national media, there's been a lot of discussion and there's a lot of awareness that's being developed on the impacts, what we can do about it. So today we're going to have a broad discussion about what is the food waste situation and some things we can do about it. What we're going to start off with is Jessica is going to talk about a few things for the audience to be aware of, some statistics, some interesting facts. It's a great way to start the conversation having this information in the beginning. So you want to share some interesting statistics here on food waste. I know you shared some before the show, and I was amazed by some of this stuff. So let's share some with the audience.
Sure, I'd be happy to. The first thing that I want to talk about for the context of this conversation, and I believe most food waste conversations, is to talk about what food waste is exactly. It's not just what you throw away at the end of your dinner. It's not like leftover food scraps. It's anything that was food that could have been used to feed the hungry or people with less food. So in addition to the food that we don't finish or already prepared food, there's like produce. Grocery stores have certain standards of how things have to look. So if the like the tomatoes or whatever it is doesn't look the way the grocery store wants it to, the growers usually try to get rid of it, but end up throwing a lot away.
So the food waste is not just what I didn't finish my meal. It's also what the stores do.
Mm-hmm.
It sounds like as a society, we expect our food to look perfect, and anything that's a little bit imperfect, we're throwing it away.
Yeah.
Just tossing, even though it's good?
Well, I think some grocery stores try to have relationships with food banks and try to get most of their food distributed to other places.
Mm-hmm.
But 40% of that does get thrown away. A lot of food also gets thrown away. It gets pulled off the shelf for the expiration date. There's a misunderstanding of the dates on the packages.
You shared with me, and we had this discussion pre the show. Expiration dates. I'm guilty of this. When I see an item in my pantry and it's like the day past the expiration date, I just throw it out. Because I've been trained to think, well, it's no longer good. And that's not the case. What is the point of the expiration date? You can still eat it?
Yeah, there are actually a couple different ways that people, companies put put the dates on the packaging. And usually it's not an expiration date, but it's a best by date, which means that one that date is the last day that your food is absolutely perfect to the grocery store standards.
There we go, seeking perfection all the time.
No,
that's very interesting. And I think a lot of the waste is due because the expiration dates are misleading. Okay.
So I had prepared some slides, but I forgot to send them to the TV show. So you can visit the city's website under the solid waste pages.
This is going to be an ongoing conversation. Mm-hmm. So we're going to start showing some stuff on the city website. You're going to hear a lot more about this in the coming months. So this is just the beginning. In a part two show, you can bring them.
Okay. So I'll share one that I think is really interesting. Mm-hmm. In 2010, America wasted enough food to fill the Empire State Building 91 times. And that's just one country for 1 year. So
wow, that's,
we can start with there.
Just try to visualize that. I'm so just looking at some stuff here. It's something to consider. $2,275 is the cost of food discarded by the average American family each year. I come from a family of four, so I'm wasting $2,275 a year and just throwing food out. That's just amazing. It's an amazing number. And then I was just looking at like one or two other statistics. Here it says 63 million tons of food a year have been wasted, and we spend $218 billion. Now, this is global, I believe. This is a global thing on this discarded food. It just seems such a waste. Just a terrible thing to do. So is that any, you got a couple other things to share?
Well, besides the economics, I watched a documentary, and it was, it's called Just Eat It, and you can watch it on Amazon Prime for free. And they gave statistics that also involved like producing the food, and it says that when you have a barbecue, one hamburger that doesn't get eaten represents, like for example, water. It's 90 minutes of a shower is how much water went in to making the food to feed the cow, and also the water to feed the cow to make the hamburger. So there's a huge water loss as well.
I mean, the really end game for the food waste situation is the food waste should be going to feed people, not feeding the landfills. It just seems like such a good food is being wasted. Now, Lucine, let's talk about, do you have anything else?
Okay. Well, in addition to reallocating our food waste, there are a lot of things that you could do to just reduce food waste in general. Mm-hmm. They'll be on our website, but a couple things are, think more about what you're buying when you go to the grocery store. Don't do impulse buying. Mm-hmm. Lots of restaurants have, if you ask for a half a portion, you can get one even if it's not on the menu, and they'll usually reduce the price. You can use your freezer a lot more for a lot more things mm-hmm. than I think people think.
In the American culture, and I think you can find this in many other cultures, what is it, and we're just as guilty at home about this, meal size. I always serve more than I eat. What is it? We always cook more than what we need. And you know, you want to have leftovers and they work good, but some things just don't work as leftovers. It just doesn't work because you end up tossing it out. Mm-hmm. So we can do a better job of just making foods that fit our portion of what we really are going to eat.
Yeah.
It's just a psychological thing. We just feel like you have to make more than what you need.
Yeah, I think some of the things I read is that it comes from the establishment of human culture switching over from hunting and gathering right. To showing prosperity by having food to spare and extra food. Mm-hmm. And we just sort of have never really transitioned away from that sign of having a lot of food as a sign of security.
About 2-3 weeks ago, as I was preparing for the show, I was trying to seek a topic. I was thinking, well, what can we talk about? We talk a lot about recycling, trash disposal, anti-litter. In a local media about 3 weeks ago, there was an editorial, and it talked about globally that France is the first nation in the globe here in the world to ban supermarkets from discarding or destroying unsold food. So I went on the internet to do a little bit more research to understand what that was all about. And in some countries and some areas, that if they can't sell it or they just got discarded because it wasn't perfect, they pour bleach on it to destroy the food so people don't scavenge it and just all kinds of stuff. And it's real interesting just how France is taking a lead on it. So I thought this would be a great topic for today's show. Mm-hmm. So that kind of led to the topic about food waste. And it looks like this is one of these topics that we're not going to be able to cover everything today. This is could be something for the next couple shows. We could focus on different aspects of it. So very interesting statistics. Do you have anything else or any other statistics that jump out there?
We have like 4 years of statistics that I want to do other things. We do have other shows,
but that's fine. You can see anything that jumps out. We'll do a show just on statistics, yes.
One thing that I did think was kind of interesting is that there is this misconception that some grocery stores have that if they throw, they can't give food away or sell it at a reduced price because people could get sick and sue them. And there's actually a Good Samaritan Act that protects businesses from being sued in a situation like that.
And it was an act in 1996. This was an editorial. So it's been around a long time. Mm-hmm. So I think it's important to know. So that this discussion of food waste, I think it's been out there. I just think it's becoming more more aware. I think communities become more aware than ever before. Okay, well, that's really, really good information. It really sets the conversation, sets the tone on the issue of food waste, what is food waste, and what we can do about it. Now, Lucine, being the director of food systems director, food systems, tell me a little bit.
Yeah,
tell
what,
the audience a
what
little
is food that, right?
That's a good question.
Yeah, and as we talk about food and food waste, I love to put positive connotations mm-hmm. on things. So for food waste, that's really exciting for me. Mm-hmm. Because when we look at food waste, it's part of our food system. And when we look at our food systems, we look at the whole spectrum, the full mm-hmm. circle. So you could take that journey of food maybe from the very beginning as mm-hmm. a seed and in the soil with our farmers and having the food grown. Mm-hmm. And then, where does that food go? Is it sold by the farmers? Is it sold to restaurants? Is it sold to grocery stores? And then what do those individuals do with the food? So mm-hmm. let's look at a restaurant. A restaurant mm-hmm. would then have a chef prepare the food mm-hmm. and, as Jesse was talking about, served. And then once the meal is finished, where does it go?
Right.
But, it goes back to also the farms mm-hmm. where it starts. So not all the food that's grown is harvested and meets all the standards and is distributed. And so there's food left in the fields that can become food waste.
You kind of alluded to that a little bit, Jesse. So is that a big component here of food waste?
That's definitely a big component.
Wow, I didn't realize that. So it's not, even before it gets in my hands, it's not even
It can
there.
Be food waste. But like I said, food waste is like liquid gold.
Right,
it is energy, it is nutrients, and we're going to talk about that a little bit later.
Oh, great.
So I want to say that even though food waste is a concern, mm-hmm. There's many positive outcomes from our food waste and programs through our systems. And so that's what I try to do through Redesign Reading.
So instead of feeding the landfills, there's so much more we can do with the food waste.
Yeah,
so
absolutely.
It's a product. It's meant to be used for something.
Yeah, we can feed the worms and we can feed the earth and we can
feed
future crops and feed our animals. So that's really, an area of focus mm-hmm. For the work that I do. Because like you said, food systems
directors. I'm thinking of the nutrition chart when you say food system.
Yeah, sure.
Grains. Yeah. That's what I saw about.
Remember that food pyramid?
Yeah, that's
right.
Now it's
my plate.
Yeah, exactly. That's the new one. That's when I think of food system, I think about what I should be eating daily.
Yeah. And that's a big part of it. Education, nutrition education. Mm-hmm. So, Redesign Reading is a community development corporation that serves our community as a nonprofit. And we focus on community and economic development. Mm-hmm. And a vital part of that development is through our food systems. Mm-hmm. And I could talk, 35 minutes just about food systems alone, but we don't have that time. Mm-hmm. So I want to focus on what we are doing to mm-hmm. address food waste specifically. Mm-hmm. One of the areas that I'm lucky enough to be a part of with Redesign Reading is what we call our Food Policy Council. And it has a really great long name. So it's the Regional Reading Food Policy Action Council, right? But we call it the Food Policy Council. And this was something that formed about a year and a half ago, and it was formed by not only Redesign Reading, but a lot of our community partners. So mm-hmm. the Reading Health System was involved, Penn State Health St. Joseph was involved, we have our Berks Community Health Center, we have the Greater Berks Food Bank, we mm-hmm. have farmers, we have business owners, we have community members, and everybody came together and said, we're concerned about our food systems. We want to be part of a council, mm-hmm. whether it's action-based or advisory-based, mm-hmm. to make a difference. And a year and a half later, we have a thriving food policy council that has five different segments. One of them is focused on zero waste. Mm-hmm. And when we talk about zero waste, food waste is a really important part of that.
I just saw one of these many statistics. I think it's like 40% in the landfill is organics, and obviously food waste is a big part of that.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
If we're trying to, our goal is zero waste,
yeah.
Well, we got a long way to go
right.
Until we got to address the food part. So
we do, and we're taking just really small steps,
mm-hmm.
things that, you know, we have great big visions, which
sure.
I'm really happy to say. You know, here in Berks County, there are a lot of community members
mm-hmm.
who have great visions. We're looking outside and thinking outside of the box.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, maybe I should say we're thinking outside of that trash container,
right?
And, you know, what can we do with this? One of the things that we've accomplished most recently is something that we've done with the Greater Berks Food Bank.
Mm-hmm.
And so the Greater Berks Food Bank is receiving a lot of donations of fresh produce and highly nutritious food. And although they have a great new facility, there's a very short turnaround time of how to get this food out, and then also how the food bank works, you know, with that perception, unfortunately, that all of the food mm-hmm. they distribute is boxes of, you know, cereal and
right.
rice-a-roni
yeah.
and cans of vegetables and
mm-hmm.
fruit in, you know, high fructose corn syrup. So now we're really excited that, you know, the food bank is having these donations of highly nutritious food, and that this food has a way to get out to the community through what we've done through Food Policy Council, which is a mobile food bank.
Wow.
Yeah, so we have a mobile food bank. And, you know, we're starting to find different locations in our community where our members who have self-declared themselves as being in need, you know, being... being hungry. So
mm-hmm.
Food Bank is trying to address anti-hunger. And so the food bank then can go to these areas where maybe older adults are having concerns with transportation. So there are a
sure.
lot of soup kitchens and programs out there, but not everybody can get to those locations.
Right.
There's also prohibitive costs to afford transportation that usually sometimes can keep people, or there's a
right.
schedule. So what if I'm working two jobs and I can't actually get to the distribution point on Thursday at 2 p.m., or, you know, because
mm-hmm.
I have to work.
Right.
So how do I get the food that I need for myself and my family? So one thing that we discovered in conjunction with this program is that the food bank in itself
mm-hmm.
was throwing away a lot of food waste.
Because time just ran up.
And
that was, so now you're taking it to the community directly because
yes.
you've identified areas, and that's,
yes.
wow, that's a pretty new thing, right? I mean,
it's very new.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, we did the pilot.
So it's a pilot, okay.
Yep, earlier this month. And we're going to continue to, you know, define different areas
right.
in our community, Berks County. So it's not just city-based, you know,
sure.
this is a county-based program. And, you know, by being able to have these distribution sites for our fresh produce as it comes in,
mm-hmm.
Then we have seen a reduction of the food waste that's being generated,
right.
you know, from an organization that's receiving a lot of food donations.
Mm-hmm.
And there's just so many things to talk about here, but in terms of food waste, Brian Twyman,
mm-hmm.
who's also here, is somebody who really can talk about that as a leader for our Food Policy Council in
Great.
Zero Waste.
So Brian, the director of the outreach for Permacultivate, tell us just a quick thing, Permacultivate, tell us about Permacultivate.
Permacultivate's a nonprofit that started 4 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
We are based in the city greenhouse in the city of Reading, and we hope to just educate people on everything that we're talking about today.
Mm-hmm.
Most of our focus is food security and food justice,
security.
Which
mm-hmm.
goes into food policy and everything that Lucine has talked about prior, as well
mm-hmm.
as what Jesse's talking about. Right now we have the pleasure of working with people like Lucine
mm-hmm.
and the Farmers Market and the Food Policy Council to be a part of what we're working for, and that's educating the public on the importance of food and every aspect of food, everything from what you eat, where you eat it, where it's grown, and local sustainability. So sustainability is the magic word that I really want to include in all of this.
Mm-hmm.
Sustainability is as simple as knowing what's going to happen next. Okay, so if we only had a little bit of juice here and we had to split it between all
mm-hmm.
of us, we'd have to share. And if we didn't share, it wouldn't last. I
mm-hmm.
could drink it all very easy, and Lucine would get none, you would get none. So it's knowing that there's finite amounts of materials, food, so be it, anything. And we have to figure out a way to be conscious of how to either stretch it or how to make it work for everyone. So sustainability is very important in the concept of everything we're talking about. And I always like to talk, Frank and I have worked a lot in the past with trash and recycling. And just issues like these ladies are here with us all talking about. Food happens to be the next generation of what we all need to start focusing on. So in saying that, we say reduce, reuse, recycle. Okay, reduce. So first of all, with our waste and our food, we have to think about it. What are we eating? Like Jesse made a really good comment. You can ask for half a portion. You can say, hey, I know I'm not really going to eat this. Let's just get a half a portion. And in our homes, we don't have to make a whole bunch of food because if we're not going to eat it, then we're not. But if we do, we can keep leftover sizes and things like that. So the first thing is reduce. And the same thing applies with our waste. We have to really think about what kind of things we're going to produce. Then we can worry about what the
really
waste is.
It's changing of a thought.
Yeah, it is.
It's changing of thinking, changing of doing things.
It really is. And that's a great point. And so reuse. So what can we reuse? Great point that you guys made earlier about the labels. Frank, you said it. People look at their label and say, oh no, this is gone, this is no good. It really has to do with business, you know. So when you think about what the label says, you wouldn't want someone giving you bad things. And if you're selling it, you got to produce the best product you can. So that doesn't mean the food is bad, it just means it's not optimal.
And one of the things when my wife and I go food shopping, you know, we go to one of these places where they sell bulk items,
right.
And it's just like you think again is value. But I end up not using all of it because it really does go bad in some cases. And like, did I really need to buy that big container or something?
Right.
Did I really? Because I wasn't ever going to use it. Am I really saving the money?
That's right.
But there's this, you know, just it's big. I'm making a deal about this. And that's something the industry sometimes, I think, doesn't help either.
Right.
They, you know, this is a better thing. And you know, a lot of people are going to waste it.
Absolutely. So with reuse and recycle, we can always reuse things that we have.
Right.
We know that. But do we know that we can reuse our garbage and our waste and it has its own purpose? So I'll talk to a little bit more about that, but I would like, you know, to continue to get, you know, Jess has something to say. So go ahead, Jess.
Yeah, I was just thinking about when Brian, you were talking about reuse. I was looking at this website. I think it's endfoodwaste.org. I wrote it down somewhere. But if you go to that website, they have all these resources, and one of them is a place where it's like a recipe resource, and you can type in what leftovers you have and what food you have, and it will spit out a few ideas of what you could cook.
That's awesome.
With those.
I've heard about that.
So there's a reuse example.
Excellent.
But that's awesome because when you think about the food, sometimes, for example, Thanksgiving, we all eat a lot. And people say, all right, well, we got turkey sandwiches, we're good. And then, but there's so many other things you can do. And it's creative minds and it's all of us and all of culture being educated to think more about what we do because we have a say. And if we don't teach our next generation of leaders, of children, to do these things, we are not going to be sustainable and we're not going to survive in the way that we're practicing the things we're doing now. So it's really interesting.
You know, Brian, I agree. It's all about changing our behavior or our culture. And, you know, simple programs, you know, of growing your own food, whether it's, you know, in your kitchen, in your backyard, with community gardens. There's so many ways, and you don't have to grow everything that you eat, but if you grow at least one thing that you eat, you're automatically connected. You become mindful of what it, how food grows, you know, what goes into it. Jesse's example of the water, know, in a hamburger, one hamburger, you know, relating it to the cow.
That's right.
And, you know, that's a really great example. And then, you know, what we can do with that food, you know, preserving our food, different techniques that have been passed down for thousands of years is just really a good way for us to kind of catch up with ourselves and make these changes behaviorally in our homes and our everyday lives.
And Lucine and Jesse and Frank, you know, we're all advocates of change and changing the cultures, just like you said. And I know, Lucine, you manage a lot with the food system and the farmers market, which is a really great thing in which we talk about things related to sustainability and local food systems. That the fact that a lot of that food's going to be local is huge. So, you know, there's a lot of things you could say about that.
you could, the one thing I want to say is that if you have any questions about the farmers market, about the Food Policy Council, you know, if you want to reach out and share comments, you can certainly go to our website, which is redesignreading.org, and get involved. But I do want, Brian, I want you to talk about this really cool kit that you have, because we're going to try to bring this to the farmers market this year to work with our food waste. So tell us about this.
So thank you, Lucine. I'm going to make this happen really, really, really fast.
Only a few minutes left
really,
in the show.
Really fast. So very this curious. Container, you might say, what is this? Well, it's just a bucket that's resealable, okay? So the idea is that everything's contained in there. And if you haven't seen one of these buckets, they're really cool. We will have them available at permacultivate.org. So what happens is food waste can go directly into this, okay? Mm-hmm. Once the food waste is placed into it, this special brand, it's called Bokashi, allows your food to start a fermentation process that turns it into re-nourishment for your soil. So all it is a way to contain your food waste mm-hmm. safely, and also helps a little bit with the smell.
Which is big.
So it helps with the smell, and then you just sprinkle a little bit about this. And Bokashi is a system of effective microorganisms. So mm-hmm. it's a special way of saying special bacteria that can help speed up the process of composting your soil and composting your food waste. And then mm-hmm. in turn, if you let it sit and you keep it closed for 2 weeks, the process has begun, another 3 weeks, and you almost have compostable fermenting food. All wow. you do is you could either bring that back to permacultivate, right. or if you have a garden area, you just mix that in as a soil amendment.
So I can put that in my kitchen?
You can sit that right in
all
your
right.
kitchen.
Because in the summer, I do some food compost. I'm trying to experiment with it. But in the wintertime, I don't want to be stuffed in the kitchen. Yeah. That looks pretty. I can fit that in my kitchen. Yeah. It looks pretty reasonable.
It's really nice. And along with that, you know, it almost just leads into being respectful and responsible mm-hmm. for what you can do with it. And everybody can do this. So contact myself, Lucine, Jesse, or Frank.
And you mentioned the website. If I wanted to find more about that, what website is it?
You can go to the audience quick. www.permacultivate.org. Or you can even send mm-hmm. me an email at brian@permacultivate.org, and you can find more information. But certainly contacting anyone at this table will get you in the right direction.
Absolutely. And what we're going to do on the city website, as we talk more about this issue next couple months, we're going to add a section to the city website so you can use it as a resource also, and we'll have some links to some of the things that were spoken about today. As you can see, there's a lot to talk about food waste, and we just started the conversation today on just the real broadness of it, what is food waste, and how it affects us and what we can do about it. But as you can see, there's a lot more to talk about, and the next couple shows, I think we're going to focus on the food waste. I'm hoping that our next show, which is 2 months from now, we may pay a visit to the farmer's market. And I think we'll see what we can do. We'll see if we can put something like pre-table. We'll come down to farmer's market. Yeah. And we only got a minute left, but a quick plug. When is the farmer's market? I think it's going to start before our next segment.
Farmer's market opens June 2nd, and it's the 400 block of Penn Street at Penn Square. So we hope to see everybody come out. And again, if you visit the city's website or redesignreading.org, you can get all the information.
Great. So then our next show, we'll be able to visit on site and see what we can do. Great topic. Very interesting topic. It's a new topic, at least for me, I think many other people. So I'd like to thank our guests. Thank you very much. Thank you for your enthusiasm, your information. And I have to tell you, I'm going to open invitation. I'll be inviting everybody to the next couple of shows, and we'll start working from there. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
And I'd like to thank our audience for tuning in, and we look forward to seeing you on our next show.